Children and cartoons. Good morning, everybody. My name is Kyla Bradley. I'm a student here at Pewaunee High School, and today I'll be walking you through my research inquiry process. So, first off, I'm going to tell you how I got into this idea. So, when we were doing our research inquiry process, I was watching an episode of Adventure Time at the time. I was really catching up on all the shows, and it came up with this gender-specific pronoun, like, problem in the show. And I realized that, you know, gender-specific pronouns are something that's, like, really prevalent in our generation as of right now. So I was thinking, does that have any correlation with the problems that we have now? Did this cartoon somehow make its way into how we look at gender-specific pronouns these days? So before I get into my entire presentation, I just have some definitions that I would like to address. My first definition is activism, which is the effort to promote, impede, direct, and social, political, economic, or environmental reform. My second one is animation, the technique or photography. The photography, successful drawing or position of puppets to create an illusion of movement when a movie is shown in sequence. Cognitive, the mental process of acquiring knowledge and understanding through thought, experiences, and the senses. Ethics, which is the moral principles that are given in a person's behavior or the conducting of an activity. Inclusion, the action or state of including or being included within a group or structure. And then morals and person's standards or behaviors concerning what is and what is not acceptable for them to do. So my research process. So my initial research question is, how has every generation portrayed activism and inclusion within their cartoons? Cartoons such as Studio Universe, which is a Cartoon Network film, and Popeyes, which is a Paramount Plus show, contribute to the inflictions of ethics and morals on the younger viewers, ages 6 months to 10 years old. So some questions that might pop up. What is the significance of my study? So the purpose or the reason that I feel like this study is important is because if we can figure out that there is some correlation between children and their developmental process of them learning cartoons, then we can somehow incorporate that into our future for our other children or for just people in general. And we can show them maybe sometimes we won't have to go to school someday. Maybe sometimes if we watch videos like YouTube videos or shows, we can learn those things, ethics and morals through those shows if we can prove that there's some way of correlation that might help us overall in the future. And then a problem with my research is most of the studies are behavioral studies, and since I want to focus more on the physical manifestation of ethics and morals in society, there wasn't a lot of things with that. So I just want to see, prove, or even just find out if there is a physical manifestation of those properties. A couple gaps that I found are in my research. So some questions that I had was, is the amount of screen time you give your child enhances their learning experience? The cartoon problem includes a generational problem, and are putting morals / ethics in cartoons actually teaching kids the values of life? So, my hypothesis. Cartoons do have an effect on the child's cognitive behavior, and that this effect resides in whatever cartoons project to the children in order to change or learn something in the process. So, here are some limitations or potential issues I felt that was going to be a problem in my research process. The first one is not having an advisor who can assist me on my topic. I feel like if I didn't have an advisor, I wouldn't be able to be in the right direction because I specifically don't know much about my topic until I'm in the research process. Two, not having internet or cable access to watch certain films. So since I will be doing a content analysis, which I'll be talking about later, if I don't have access to the internet or cable, I cannot watch the films that are needed for the study. Three, calculating my data wrong and getting inaccurate numbers. If my data is incorrect in any possible way, it can screw up my entire research process, and then all of my data will be false, or it won't lead to my hypothesis or even my research question. And then four, the chosen method tool may not have enough information to make reasonable conclusions. So the research method tool that I use will be a research rubric draft, which I will get into later. And if since I'm looking for specific key details, if I don't have those specific key details or if I don't put that in the accurate spots, it might not give me the accurate data that I need to perform my research process. So here are a couple sources for my literature review that I use versus generational differences charts. This is basically just telling in each generation from the traditionalist generation to generation X, I believe, about their family morals, how they present themselves in society, their views on money, their views on their housing and living, and then how they attack authority and things of stuff like that. The social cultural influences on moral judgment, that's basically a study base that goes with religion, cultural beliefs, races, and gender things like that. So they just wanted to see like what are the different morals, ethics, and genders, races, cultural differences, and men and, between men and women, and even older people, and how is that different from the Western Hemisphere and the Eastern Hemisphere. And then some more sources is Episode Ninja. Episode Ninja is where I found all my content analysis that showed me episodes where there was the people who were my most episodes, my most watched episodes, my most popular episodes, and my most popular shows. That's how I got my content analysis. And then first things first, a brain development. That is just my base study. I use that to start off with the newborns, like from 6 months to about 3 years old, and just how the cognitive process works in general. And then, so my content analysis sources, this is what I used before. I had bomb troubles and cross-country detours, which is from the 40s to the 50s. The Jets and the Flintstones is just the 60s, the 70s, Chippendales, the 80s, and 90s. And the Crossfire was like the 90s, 2000s, to 2010s with the Teen Titans. So this is my method process analysis project. So the method approach that I used was a content analysis. A content analysis is the study of documents, communication artifacts, which might be text of various formats, pictures, or audio. I used this specific method research because this was the only way that I could gather the most accurate data. And with the content analysis, it will help me be able to fully understand what I am learning, so I can transcribe it and get others to learn, like put it in simpler terms and have others learn, like this is a problem, something we should probably focus on. And then my correlational analysis is a statistical method that identifies the strength of a relationship between two or more variables. And I use this correlational analysis because I will be using other, I was going to be using other scholarly studies. I will be using other scholarly studies. So to go with my context analysis, I need the correlational analysis to help me provide the scholarly studies and the data that I get by context analysis. Okay, so here's my research tool, my data gathering. I'll be using the scatter plot for my correlational analysis. This is how I will provide the information that I get from my correlational analysis. And then this is my rubric draft, which is I basically had most popular, the popular episodes, representation. So all of these categories, I would go through each and every show, and I would pick out if there was a female lead, if there were people of color, if there was LGBTQ representation. And I will also pick out the offensive terms and slurs / stereotypes each show. And then I have it going from the Pluto cartoons, which is the 40s, all the way down to Adventure Time, which is the 2010-ish. So here's a visual data of my gathering process from March 2nd all the way to March 18th. I was gathering data. That's when I was doing my context analysis and looking for data. From the 21st to the 31st, that's when I was calculating and analyzing all my results. I was grabbing my data, calculating the numbers, putting them in my rubric draft, and then putting them in Google Sheets and grabbing my graphs from there. Okay, so then how did I remain ethical? This was strictly content analysis. I had no people in this. I provided no surveys. I did not interview anybody. This was just strictly me looking at shows, looking at documents, other scholarly articles. And then I recorded results in a reasonable time. So my time frame was from 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. I didn't go over, I didn't go under. So I was just making sure if I did go a little bit over, it wasn't too extreme lengths. I wasn't up till 5 a.m. doing data, so I wasn't like exacerbating myself while doing this study. And then I stretched out my workload. So before I showed you my data gathering process, I stuck to that specifically. I didn't do anything else that I wasn't supposed to. I had a strict timeline and schedule of what I was going to do. And then lastly, I did not mention any offensive terms or phrases because they are offensive. I did not provide any of that. I do have timestamps in my literature review and even in my discussion section in my paper that have the timestamps, but I did not specifically state the offensive terms or phrases. So here are my results. So some problems that I came across was my correlational analysis failed due to lack of data. So I wasn't able to find the scholarly articles that I mentioned before. It was really hard for me because I wasn't sticking to my demographic. And so since I wasn't able to use my correlational analysis, I wasn't able to use my scatter plot either. So since I wasn't able to use the scatter plot, I did end up changing, going to Google Sheets, and I used Google Sheets in order to help me graph my pie charts, and I even used a comparison chart, which was a bar graph. And then lastly, I had to change two of my content analysis sources due to unavailability. So I had to change Teen Titans and Cross Country which were two shows from the 40s and 2010s, I changed them to the Mighty Mouse and to Adventure Time because they were unavailable and I couldn't find them on any other platforms. So here's my actual results. For offenses and phrases, you can see that The Jetsons, which is a 50-ish film, is 31.9%. That had the most offensive terms inside the entire, the average. So basically what I did was I went through each show and I calculated how long was it, let's say it was, they were being offensive for about 5 seconds. So however many minutes it was, so Jetsons was a 25 minute time frame, I calculated that into seconds. And then however long it was offensive for, I calculated that up and then I put it into Google Sheets and that's how I got this pie chart. And then you can see that the least amount of offensive was the Care Bears, which was at 1.5%. And then in the ranges, you can see Mighty Mouse and Pluto and Flintstones. It just gets smaller and smaller from there as the time goes on. And then representations of subliminal messages per episode. We can see that Adventure Time now makes its way to the top with 33.4%. And then the Flintstones has 0.5% of representations and subliminal messages, which makes sense because it was the most offensive show during that time. Okay, so here's some comparison. So for the offensive terms, you can kind of see that it's getting smaller and smaller over time. And then for messages and representation, it's slowly starting to come up. The Plutos and the Jetsons have the least amount of representation in their shows, but they also have the highest amount, as you can see. So what's next? What advice would I provide for future researchers? So some data that I'm still missing. Data on different races, genders, etc. So by this I mean, for my future researchers, I would suggest you that they look into specifics. How do cartoons affect people of color? How do cartoons and not having representation affect people of the LGBTQ community? How do they affect the people who have disabilities who are not represented in those films? So I was missing things like that. If generational problems are put into cartoons. So I was basically focused on if cartoons help promote generational problems. But what else would be another thing to look at is if generational problems are actually put into cartoons. So like, are they doing it on purpose to actually bring awareness to these issues? And then lastly, other perspectives from various shows. So since I did use the most popular episodes and the most popular shows, I might not have got the most data. So if they could look at shows that maybe are the least popular, but they have like a lot of offensive terms or a lot of representation, I believe they should look into things like that as well. Okay, and then lastly, for time, I advise my future researchers to start gathering data and analyzing their sources early, because that was a little problem that I was having, which is why I wasn't able to find the data that I needed exactly. So time, please make sure that, you know, you work on your time. For ideas, I said thoroughly plan out exactly what you're looking for. Know what demographics that you're looking for, what specific details do you need for your research in order for your research to get, you know, maximum efficiency. And then advisor. I strongly suggest getting in touch with somebody who is a professional or somebody who at least knows something on this topic. The reason why I was having so much time is because I didn't have somebody to steer me in the correct direction for things such as, you know, where to look and what exactly I'm looking for. And then where to look, I say go to libraries or ask others, like anybody around you, because the internet is not always helpful. The internet was giving me a lot of broad specific data that I didn't really need, and that was consuming much of my time. Thank you. I'm ready for questions.
What might be the real world implications or consequences, such as influence on others' behaviors, decision-making processes, or discoveries related to your findings?
So I believe that if we can figure out that these cartoons do have an effect on our children, if they start promoting more awareness and more things like subliminal messages or even just, being good people, that right there can automatically help our kids grow up to be more open-minded and have them look at things in different situations and not be so biased towards things like most people are today.
And secondly, what unanticipated term did you encounter as your research progressed? What were the reasons for this change in direction or focus, and how did you modify your method or approach?
Okay, so something that was the lack of data. So I had to mid my method approach, I had to change the way I was going to be calculating this data. So because I wasn't able to use my scatter plot, I had to hurry up and come up with something fast that was going to help me, that was going to help me accurately put out my data and what my data was for, which is why I had to change from a scatter plot and a correlational analysis to strictly content analysis, because if I was to go on